Hello guys, now we want to see the ductile and the brittle behavior. Okay. Okay. So we know what is a ductile material which has got long elongation or larger elongation. And brittle material are those which have very short elongation, or you can say it breaks at the point of plastic limit. Okay, now so for a typical ductile one, the graph would be like this. For a brittle one, this is for ductile, this is your stress, this is your strain, engineering stress and strain. So here stress, strain. Okay, so this is just the elastic limit. So just after small deformation we say that it has broken. Okay, so it means that a brittle material also shows some amount of plastic deformation, that is very little. Okay, so these things happen in the case of metal, but in the case of glasses, you think what happens? It just breaks. Okay, because that is considered as a totally brittle material. Okay. Now guys, like if the failure happens, then what are the things which happens inside the material, right? So till now here you can see, suppose this is the ductile one and we are getting the failure over here. Okay, then we have got this elastic deformation, right? Then we also got this plastic deformation and ultimately fracture. Okay, and one more thing is like the failure mechanism, whether it is ductile or brittle, is not so absolute. Okay, so whatever the failure mechanism which is there, so that depends on various factors. Okay, so what are the factors? Like temperature, strain rate, number of defects, then like type of loading, then type of loading, then like strain rate, defects, type of loading, then environment. In the case of corrosive environment also, sometimes the ductile material fails by brittle nature. Okay, so this failure mechanism is dependent on these factors. That means if we decrease the temperature, then a ductile one can behave like a brittle one, which happens because at lower temperature the movement of slip is difficult. Okay, and a brittle one, if we for a brittle one, if we increase the temperature, then some amount of ductility is also shown. Okay, so these things do happen, right? Now guys, there is a term called as factor of safety. Now while designing any structures, any components, we assume that certain amount of force will be there, or the stress will be there. Okay, that means a machine will experience certain amount of stress. So we take materials, we take a structure such that the amount of stress which will be applied over there, so that should always be lower than the yield strength of that metal, because after this yield stress, what happens? The material starts deforming. Okay, deforming in a permanent way. So we do not want any permanent deformation. Although in a machine, if it happens small amount of elastic deformation, it is of no major consequence. Okay, yeah, it happens. All machines, if you see, are designed up to the yield stress point or the maximum, the elastic limit. Okay, this is the elastic limit. So all machine components are designed such that the stress which it bears should be lower than this point. Okay, so this is just a boundary. But sometimes suppose the stress increases at a local point also, then this can go beyond this stress, right? So there is a chance of failure. So that's why engineers have taken this factor of safety. In the factor of safety, what happens? The formula is like, what is the yield strength of the material divided by the stress applied. That's what is the maximum amount of stress which will be applied. This is your factor of safety, FOS. Okay, so what will be the unit of this factor of safety? So there will be no unit, right? Because this is division of two same unit quantity. Okay, now so that means, suppose this is your YS here, 200 MPa, and I design such that the maximum is 100 MPa stress. So whatever is the factor of safety, FOS is equal to 200 by 100. Okay, and generally factor of safety is taken as like 2, 3, 4. Okay. Now some engineers also define factor of safety in terms of UTS here. So here FOS in terms of UTS, so it will be like UTS value divided by the stress applied. Okay, so this will also give you the value. Okay guys, fine. Now guys, we have assumed that a force which acts on a body is continuous. That means same amount of force it is acting. Okay, but it also doesn't happen. Even if you apply some force, then what happens due to different regions of this material will experience different force. But we take generally the average force, and accordingly we calculate the average stress, right? So to understand that, so suppose at a point O we have got a stress P, right? Okay, now we have got a stress P. So what happens now? We will draw the different axes, like the coordinates. Suppose this is your x axis, this is your y axis, then this is your z axis, which is the normal one. So this stress will make some angle with the normal, that is theta, and this stress will also make some angle with x and y. Okay, so what happens here, we try to understand what is the stress distribution at this point in different coordinates. Okay, so stress distribution in different coordinates. Fine. Now in the normal axis, that is z, stress equal to p cos theta, right? everyone. So stress in z direction will be p cos theta, and stress on surface will be how much? It will be p sin theta, right? So like suppose this. Now it makes some angle phi, okay. It makes some angle phi, then we can further divide this stress in x and y direction, as in y it will be cos phi, in the x direction it will be okay guys, so let me discuss further.